more importantly, who gets off the line first.
The lights are on. Ooh, red. They flash to green.
Lights.
And a bit of a jump on the lights, but it's been allowed. And it's Dirk Raudies who leads on the Honda. Without a doubt, it's Raudies number five. Raudies leads into the left-hander.
They should have stopped that, because that was terrible. That was really bad jump to the lights. You know, there were guys that were whole bike in front of somebody else.
Raudies leads, and it looks like Sakata in second place. So Germany leads Japan, the pack safely through, then through the hairpin, up the hill they'll go. As you can see, perfect conditions, but Raudies leads, fifth in the World Championship last year. In fact, he won his first ever Grand Prix last year, but a very experienced campaigner at this level of competition. And it's Luke Bordelia, the Dutchman, in third place.
Yeah, and I think Oliver Koch in fourth place. Now, you see, that's nice and quite closely bunched. Ralph Waldman was in about seventh place, so that's not too bad for him. But I didn't see Giro. I didn't see what kind of start. I think he was actually waiting for the lights to go green, which is more than could be said for some of the other blokes.
Yes, certainly. He seemed to get caught by the start. But Raudies leads. Sakata in second place. Bordelia third. And in fourth place, absolutely right, Barry, Oliver Koch riding the Honda.
Yeah, Giro's way back. You cannot afford, you have to get up the front on the first couple of laps in this race, because otherwise you'll specifically see Giro. No, can't see him. He's a pretty long way back, and that is... I really do feel they should have red flagged that, because that was very unfair.
But it's closing up very nicely indeed on this opening lap. Sakata now closing on Raudies, Bordelia closing up on Sakata. These three just opening up a little bit of a gap over Oliver Koch. They're over the start and finish line. Now, the end of the first lap of the 125cc Grand Prix is lining up nicely. And Waldman now we can see in fifth place, and he won't be too unhappy about being fifth.
No, because he's not out of the hunt. So Bordelia, the guy that's running third, surprised everybody in practice, because he was very, very quick and very, very smooth. So you see there, guy in third making a lot of ground on braking. You see he went in sort of gained 6 or 7 meters, which on one of these things is an arm and a leg.
How difficult is it to make up ground on a 125 with a lack of tops, real top speed and real acceleration?
Well, the reason it's so close is because the bikes are all so equal, so you really can't afford to be back as far as, say, Giro is at the moment. Because don't forget, Raudies that we see there leading, he's very, very quick. He was only sort of slightly off the pole position, and you can't afford to give away. Don't forget, Giro's given away 3 seconds as it stands now, and you've got to make that up. So that means you've got to go an awful lot quicker than the guys in front, and it's virtually impossible in this kind of racing.
And Ralph Waldman's up into fourth place. One would imagine he's beginning to think that he doesn't want Raudies to get too far in front, and he's got to get past these guys in front of him, Bordelia and Sakata, really, to have a go and not let him get too far away. There's Waldman. We just caught him.
Somebody down.
We have a faller.
Somebody down. Can't quite see.
Perfectly okay, but obviously his race has run. So the first faller of the 1993 season. Not a happy name to put on somebody. But now back to the race at the front. This is Bordelia in third place, but Waldman is closing on. Carlos Giro down in 12th place. That's a disaster from pole position.
It really is a disaster, because it's you're going to struggle. He's a second and a half behind now, well, 1.6 seconds behind. So that is not too bad. That is not so bad. I was kind of thinking he'd be sort of three to four seconds behind. So there's plenty of time yet. It's a 26-lap race, and when the old tyres start getting hot, we should see quite a lot of action.
Good battle now for fourth place, with Waldman coming up behind Bordelia, and they're closing up a little bit there. But Raudies out in front. What will he be thinking now? Sheer concentration, trying to pull away from everybody else?
Absolutely, trying to get this lot out of his hair. You know, that's the main thing, because what you try and do is get as much ground as you can so they slow each other down. Okay, we go down to Daryl in the pits.
Yeah, thanks, Barry. We're just talking about that start. Wayne Rainey had a look at it, and Wayne Barry thought it probably should have been aborted, because she held them a long time and some got a very fair unadvantage.
Well, I think what happened this year, they've decided to make it a 2-second gap from when the light goes red to green. Obviously, a lot of the riders didn't know that, so I don't really know what the outcome is going to be. Last year, when the light would go red, riders would just take off because the guy would just go green right away. So this year, they're trying to hold that a little bit.
What about in the case of the 500s? Now you've seen that.
I'm going to wait.
Okay. That's... Have a good afternoon. There you are. Well, that's interesting, Barry.
Oh, yeah, that really is, Daryl, because, you know, it, obviously there's been a rule change and people haven't read the rule book, but I thought there was something wrong because I've never seen it as bad as that, and I really do feel they should have stopped the race.
Yeah, well, Barry, there's quite a few people of the 500 riders talking about it, and there's a few managers coming back shaking their heads. They weren't too happy. So, well, it's the start of the first race of the year. Already a slight hiccup.
A little bit of aggro. Right as Wolman there on the inside of Bedelia. Wolman is the shrewdie.
Interesting to compare the speed as well of the Honda and the Aprilia then.
Yeah, the crew of Wolman are very, very good people. You know, this is not an out-and-out factory Aprilia he's on, but he's got some German technicians that are really, really bright. But as far as racecraft is concerned, Wolman is the man that really has it all together. It's the first three of Raudies, Sakata, Wolman.
Wolman's got to be the man to watch. Third in the championship last year. He won those opening two Grand Prix. I think everybody thought he was going to run away with the championship right in the Honda. He had some problems with the Honda after that. He switched to Aprilia now. Good move, I would think.
Definitely. You know, the problem was last year that they didn't keep up. Honda didn't keep up the development with the bike. The bike he had at the beginning of the year was the same thing as at the end. And the European manufacturers just kept the stride up and kept going.
And Sakata in front of him, 26-year-old from Japan. Yet another of those very good Japanese 125cc riders. Currently lying second, but Raudies in front really is getting a bit of a charge on them, pulling away. And he's going to be difficult to reel in.
They're going to struggle. He's 1.9 seconds in front of Sakata, and that is a long way. And by now, by the looks of it, Giro is not going anywhere. In actual fact, he's going backwards. He's down in 13th place now, and he's some 5 or so seconds behind. So you kiss goodbye to Giro. He's not going to shape.
Garry McCoy down in 18th place, and I'm afraid his prayers for rain haven't been answered, have they? This is Sakata anyway in second place. They're now on their fifth lap, trying hard as he can to reel back the advantage of Dirk Raudies. The left-hander at the end of the start finished straight on a 125, almost flat out, I should think, on a 125.
And very difficult because the 125s are so light, you go in there and any kind of bumps, you don't get a lot of feeling. When you start to lose the front end on a 125, by the time you get to think you're going to lose it, you've already lost it. So it's not unlike a 500 or a 250, it's heavier. You get a lot more feeling with it. As the front turns in a little bit, as you're losing it on a 500 or a 250, you can feel it. But with a 125, the tyres are so much narrower. As you feel it turning in, it's gone.
The Wolman slowly pulling back the advantage of Sakata in second place. That's the gap. Bedelia still in fourth place, and in fifth place, Oliver Kock. Wolman with a lot to do.
He's got a lot to do, but it'll be interesting to see how well Raudies hangs it all together. He's got 2.9 seconds now on Sakata, so he's doing exactly the right thing.
So five laps of the 125cc race gone. Dirk Raudies leading the way. Back shortly with all the action, the 125cc Grand Prix. He's coming under increasing pressure from Ralph Wolman. In fourth place, Luke Bedelia. Fifth place, Oliver Kock. And in sixth place, Barry Sheen's great favourite, Ezio Gianola.
Yeah, you'd have to say that Wolman is definitely going to have Sakata. You know, he's been catching little by little, but now Raudies' lead is over 4 seconds, and you've got to hand it to the guy. You know, it's quite funny when you can make a break in the 125 class, and you get a break like that. Barring anything going wrong, accidents or mechanical failure, you'd have to say that Raudies has totally got it in the bag.
Well, that's the gap between second place. That's number 8, Kazuto Sakata riding the Honda. And in third place, Ralph Wolman, the German, riding the Aprilia. Can Sakata go well in the World Championship, or would he, like a lot of Japanese riders, perhaps throw it away at vital moments?
Well, let's just hope. You see, if he has a good ride here, then he goes to Malaysia. He doesn't feel like when he gets to Suzuka, the Japanese Grand Prix, that he has to be the hometown hero and go and sort of do a banzai and throw it at the fence, as we've seen so many times with the Japanese riders at Suzuka. You kind of feel sorry for them because there's all the factory eyes on them, and it's very, very difficult for them, you know, because if one goes too slow, they don't get a bite for the rest of the season. It's very, very difficult.
Well, there's the perfect illustration, because Raudies has gone through. In second place, we have Sakata. third place, Rolf Waldman, and in fourth place, Padilla, then Oliver Koch. Number two, Grassini just coming into the frame now. That's interesting, Barry. Up into seventh place, the former world champion, and of course the man that finished second in the world championship last year. So Grassini probably getting the point.
Well, yeah, I don't want to get boring about this, but, you know, the start completely ruined it for so many people because Grassini and those guys are usually really up together and off the line. Giro now up in 11th place. You know, if they'd have all got off together, it's a sad thing. People, they have to take a stand on this, the governing body. They should have seen that. Everybody in the world just saw it and said, hang on, red flag. They'd have red flagged it. They'd have got a, you know, decent start second time round. That's what it's all about.
It does appear, though, that the riders should have known that there was only going to be a two-second gap from red to green, and Wayne Rainey probably put it right. Most of the 500 riders were watching that start. Well, you can absolutely guarantee the 250cc riders and the 500cc riders, they're not going to make the same mistake.
Yeah, but you could, you know, you always watch the start. You know, I always just watch the starts of the previous races and that, and it doesn't really mean an awful lot because they can hold you sometimes. You get a guy that just red light, green light instantaneously. Another time, you get someone hold you for 5 seconds or whatever. So it doesn't always help you.
So Rauda is just about to start his ninth lap. It was interesting what you said at the start of the race about the race distance. If you're involved in a good race, it seems like it's only 5 laps. If you're right out in front, like Rauda's is at the moment, it seems like 100 laps. Will he be thinking that at the moment?
This will be like the Indianapolis 500-mile race for Raudies, because he's way, way out on his own, 6.3 seconds in front of Sakata. So when it gets down to sort of half distance, three-quarter distance, he's going to think, when is this going to end? You see there, Waldman just having a little look at Sakata there, and it's going to be an awful long race for Raudies, and that can get difficult sometimes because you let your mind wander a little bit, you hear noises that don't exist, you think, well, I should slow down a little bit, you know, give the bike a bit more chance. Look at right, Waldman just trying to suss him up for a dive on the inside as they get around this left hand. Now watch round over the crest of the hill. I don't think he'll have enough room over the crest of the hill. Change direction. Right, now have a look here. As they go up over the top here. Might be, if he's, no, he's not close enough. I was going to say, dive up the inside, down the bottom here.
This is a good battle now for second place. It's made up for Raudies pulling away the way he has. How difficult is it to overtake on a 125? Because you haven't got that, again, that brute power to pull your way through when you can see the way in front of you.
Well, you know, it's the same with anything when you've got bikes that are virtually the same speed. Right, now what Warburton needs to do is get a good run. Now, what, see if he's, yeah, oh, good run. Nice and close. Now, if he gets a good slipstream, if he's close enough, he might just get him. That's perfect, you see, because Sakata had a look over his shoulder. Now, the Honda seems just as quick as the Aprilia, if not a little bit quicker. So he's going to struggle. He's going to have to be on the brakes.
Lap 10 of this 26-lap race, the opening round of the World 125cc Championship. And Waldman certainly does close up on the brakes as they come into the slow left-hander.
Look here, but that thing, Sakata's got more horsepower than a Waldman's bike. Waldman ran a little bit wide there. Lost a little bit of ground on the change of direction. Up over the top of this hill, there is a possibility, but you'd have to be mega brave. See up the inside there. He's definitely the quicker rider, Waldman, but he's just struggling to see a place. Now, he could, if he was just close enough, tuck it on the inside there, but the power of the Honda is just a little bit more than the Aprilia, so he's really going to struggle.
Going to have to really bide his time, isn't he?
Oh, he is, but the thing about Waldman, he's not a panicker, and he'll just keep harassing Sakata and just keep, you know, getting up close so you can hear the guy behind. And Sakata, he's got Sakata going because he keeps blimping over his shoulder the whole time, which is perfect. Now you watch out of here. Wouldn't mind betting that Sakata has a little look. Huh? There you go.
And on cue.
Yeah, right. Okay. Well, a little bit late, but he did it. There you can see, even though he looked over his shoulder, he didn't lose any ground. And you watch Warburton's good here, you see how much he gains. But when he gets to the end of the straight, oh, a little bit wide there for Warburton.
But of course, Sakata, no disrespect to him, but he is known, if he comes under a great deal of pressure, perhaps to not panic a bit, but to throw it up the road, putting it politely.
To modify the straw bales, usually. Yeah, really, Warburton's bike is very, very much down in speed.
So they're on their 11th lap. Dirk Raudies leads the way, 7.554 seconds in the lead. But a tremendous battle for second place between Sakata, that's number 8, and in third place, Rolf Waldman, number 3. That's the battle we're following at the moment. And Waldman really trying so hard to get the Aprilia in front of the Honda, but the Honda just appears to have a little bit more grunt when it comes to the grunt.
This is a great shot because you've really seen, now watch Waldman, the guy's, you see how much he makes through there, and now he's got on the inside change of direction. Yes, got him. That's where he was going to have a go before, but with the speed of Sakata's bike, if see the acceleration of Sakata's bike out of there, that's really virtually unheard of in a 125. That Waldman's going to struggle with this one. He's going to have to wait until Sakata's brain gets tired. Then he'll be able to have him, because for him to be able to have got back past Waldman that quickly, you know, it shows how much extra horsepower he's got.
This is the perfect example to anybody who thinks just motorcycle racing is all about going as fast as you can the whole time. There's a lot of brain power involved in it, isn't there?
Oh, there is, you know, and this is where, you know, that's the learning curve in a Grand Prix, you know, that people, you see a lot of guys that go quick for 6 or 7 laps. It's not that they get physically tired, they get mentally tired. And you think, well, I can't understand that. I was lapping a lot quicker at the beginning of the race. Right now, if Sakata has another look round, now he's got a slipstream. He's not lost as much as he did before. I reckon he'll have him at the hairpin.
So on the brakes at the hairpin, that's where we think he's going to have him. Around the fastest part of the course they go. And now on lap 12, Dirk Raudies still leads by a mile. Will he go up the inside on the brakes now?
Oh, just not quite close enough.
Is it going to be do or die before the end? Do you think he's going to take a few risks to get by?
I don't think he's clued up, Ralph, and he'll just wear him down. And when it comes to the last sort of 5 laps of the race, then he'll put the real pressure on, because he knows, yes, he's going to not, yes.
Just where he had it before, and he's done it again, but Sakata got him back.
Yeah, and now Sakata. It's a great shot, because you can really see the difference. No, he made a little bit of a muck-up on the change of direction there, Sakata, so you see how much Ralph's gained on him out of there. You can see the power of the Honda gaining on the Aprilia there. Now, Sakata might have a go up the inside here on the brakes, but Rouse Waldman's pretty good on the brakes.
Oh, this is a cracking race for second place. It's a race of great interest, because probably Sakata's got a little bit more power. Ralph Waldman's certainly got a little bit more experience. And you notice that Ralph Waldman doesn't look behind him when
he knows. I wouldn't be at all surprised if Sakata makes a good job of these corners here. Let's see how close. With the power of his bike, I wouldn't be at all surprised to see him get Waldman by the end of the straight.
Watch. Up the inside,
he's
around the left-hander.
He'll eat him for breakfast. Right, 1, 2, 3, out, go. See, there's the difference in the horsepower.
You've got a radio trim out there, have you, Barry?
No, it's, you know, you just can see what's going to happen a mile off.
The right. Poor old Ralph Waldman is going to do all the work again. Got, what must he feel then? He's got past him, he's done all the hard work, and now he's got to do it all again.
Well, it's just intriguing. What if this goes down to the wire, then Waldman's going to have to really have a good think about it. And it's all going to be decided sort of the last half lap of the race. Waldman is really going to have to get the old psychological battle going and sort of leave a door. And yes, he's going to get him on the chains. No. He's going to have to lead Sakata up the garden path, so to speak. He's going to have to go in a little bit slower into one of the hairpins and make Sakata think, oh, there's a space there. Dive up the inside and outbrake himself. Do you understand what I mean? Make
Absolutely.
Him go run on. That's all you have to do, you know, all you can do. That's the only choice you have open to.
Still, that overtaking manoeuvre seems to spur Sakata on a little bit. He's opening up a bit of advantage. But better remind you, Dirk Raudies out in front, 9.217 seconds in the lead. But up into fifth place, Fausto Grassini and Carlos Giro making up for that dreadful start. He's now currently in eighth place. And poor old Garry McCoy battling away, but in 16th place and just out of the point.
Yeah, well, any kind of luck, Garry will get into the points. How far behind? Oh, no, I don't think so. He's 7.5 seconds behind Sugimura at 15.
So it's Dirk Raudies leading the Australian 125cc Bike Grand Prix. We'll be back in just a moment. Lap of this 26th lap race, we're watching a tremendous battle for second place Japanese rider Kazuto Sakata still holding off the German, Ralph Warburton. But it really is good stuff, Barry.
Good stuff is an understatement. It's really, Warburton, you see how wide Warburton went then. I bet he's, the thing he's going to do straight away when he finishes this race is go and see the people from the Aprilia factory and say, look, do me a favour, I need some more horsepower. You know, that guy was just blowing me away everywhere. And there's no doubt whatsoever that Warburton is riding a lot quicker than Sakata. Sakata's going well, but Warburton is the best rider out of the two. And he just simply hasn't got the horsepower. He's sort of 5 or 6 kilometres down on the straight. Watch this, look. Now behind there, and he's trying as hard as he can. Trying as hard as he can to slipstream. He can't even sit in the slipstream, you see. 16 to 26, so another 10 laps to run. Now you saw, as they came onto the straight, the distance, how much he pulled out. Now you look, see how quick Warburton is through there, and a little go up the inside. Yes, got him.
Absolute perfect overtaking manoeuvre.
Yeah, it's good, very, very good ride of Warburton. Very, very good ride.
Now, Sakata behind him's got the faster bike. Warburton really probably won't want to show his hand too quickly, will he? Because Sakata will have the power to stick right behind him all the way through and harry him all the way through.
Well, there's the other scenario where Ralph can think, right, OK, I know what I'm going to do now. I'm going to go as hard as I can, absolutely flat traps for three laps, hoping that Sakata will get really excited and fling it at the fence. You know, that, seriously, yeah. It's because there's only a couple of ways you can get rid of someone, and that is to lead them into, you know, a sense of, oh, what, Sakata? Oh, dear me.
It's looking just a little bit ragged for the first time now he's behind Warburton. A little bit more ragged than he was when he was leading Warburton.
I have to say that was an industrial strength move there. If he'd have got through there, that would have been a hero job, because on that corner, you really cannot nip up the inside of someone there. Now watch this through these, through the lefts here. See Sakata. Now watch, see that distance now. Now let's have a look at the end of the straight. What's he got, five bike lengths? Five bikes. Now the end of straight, five, four, three, bikes, half. You see, that is a mega amount of horsepower. It's just like Waldman's thing standing still.
Would Sakata be more sensible just to stick behind him until they came onto the finish straight, till the last lap, pull out of his slipstream and go past him? Why isn't he doing it?
Exactly. Very good question. You know, it's the fact that if he had the racecraft, he would say, well, blow this for a game of soldiers. You know, I'm just going to sit behind, and I know I can absolutely nail him. He'd just come out right on Waldman's wheel, so this far behind him, going onto the start and finish straight, he's got him. He'd be past him sort of 100 metres before the start and finish line.
Is there anything Ralph Warburton can do in this situation, or is he really battling on a loser? Because surely if he's got the speed into the straight, anything Ralph Warburton does, when they get to the checkered flag, three quarters of the way down the end of the main straight, he's done for.
Well, I would say the only thing he can do is make his bike about 9 feet wide, because, you know, which they do.
So let's have a look at fourth place. Padilla still in fourth place. Grassini going very well now. He's up into fifth place. And Carlos Giro, good for Carlos Giro. He was the man, of course, that was in pole position.
What a battle this is.
This is a great battle. This is the battle for fifth.
Fifth to 11th place. This is really going to be the battle. You see this lot in here. There's some good guys in this. Grassini, Giro, Torrontegui, Koch, and Ono Wada.
So that's Padilla leading the way. In fact, it's the battle for fourth place. Grassini, Giro, Torrontegui, they're all in there. This is more the 125
race. Well, this is it. You know, you would normally expect this, apart from the faux pas at the start, this would have been the first sort of 10 guys. There's little Giro there. He's done a good job now out the slipstream past Padilla.
This is a good ride by Giro. I mean, he got absolutely caught cold at the start. Up into fourth place now from pole position. He's going to score some good world championship points. I think we've got a potential champion on view here.
Oh, without any doubt. You know, it's just a real sad thing. Look at the break in here. Yes, Padilla. Now you see Giro, really good, clued up kid. He's only 21 years old, but he knew he was leaving his break into the last. He didn't try and take a tight line because he thought, well, if anybody can outbreak me into this, then there's something radically wrong. And you see how much ground he's made up through that. That's a pretty clued up kid for 21 years old.
He's riding very well indeed. But Padilla, I must say, a Dutchman perhaps we haven't heard a great deal of, has impressed me throughout practice, yeah, and has impressed me in this race.
Yeah, he has been going very well.
Number 14 at the back of the pack. That's Oliver Cock riding the Honda. And just in front of him, Fausto Grassini, the Italian, who's won the World Championship on two occasions, second in the championship this year. I get the feeling with Grassini and with Ueda, his teammate, probably they haven't developed as well as they should have done in the winter.
Well, they were relying on the factory to do it. And I spoke to their chief engineer guy, and they can't really... Whoa, that good move there by Torrontegui, right up the inside there. He was the guy that rode the factory 250 Suzuki last year. There's a little bit of waving going on between Bedelia and Grassini there. Not quite sure what one finger means.
Yes,
I think that. And he's a 250 rider, really, Torrontegui, so he's, you know, he should go quick on a 125.
That's his return to the 125cc class, and yes, he's done well. And 32, again, is an interesting guy. Another Japanese rider, Ono. And the Japanese are doing very well. And in fact, he's really giving Piero a hard time. He's going to get up the inside of him, surely, and take him.
Yeah, but I think you watch Giro through here. I was watching him practice. Giro's so quick through this left-hander
here.
And
he's going to get him on the brakes, you reckon?
Oh, yes, and Torrontegui
has got them both.
Woohoo.
That is a tremendous... He's swooped up two riders in one go. He's now up into fourth place. Ah, that's the best overtaking manoeuvre we've seen in this race.
That's normal 125 race, isn't it? That's...
So Herri Torrontegui now up into fourth place, relegated to fifth is Carlos Giro, and in sixth place we have Ono. Don't forget, out in front, 11.00088 seconds in the lead. 11 seconds in the lead, Dirk Raudies. But Sakata still holding off Waldman, but this is going to be a battle to the finish. But as you so rightly said, if Sakata uses his head, surely now he's going to do it. But Rolf Waldman, of course, he's going to harry him all the way. He's going to try and force him to making a big mistake, isn't he?
Yeah, I think both the guys are on Dunlop tyres, so that's kind of good, because that way you're not going to get a deterioration of one guy's tyres as against the other. So it should be a nice race right to the end, you know, and... I can imagine how miffed Ralph Waldman is, because it's such a sad situation where you're riding real good and look, he'll do it, he's everything. That should be a sensational slipstream and you should pull out now and pass. But look, Sakata's thing just put it away, an arm and a leg.
7 laps to go then, the opening round of the World 125cc Championship. Waldman now surely going to give him a bit of a going on the brakes as they come into the left-hander. He's well placed there, Barry.
Bedelia out.
Oh,
what a shame.
That's been a good ride by the Dutchman. Obviously a mechanical problem, and what an unhappy finish for him.
As
I was impressed with him throughout practice. Not a man we knew a great deal about, and he'd been battling for fourth place throughout the race, but there we are, out of the race. But of course, it brings Carlos Giro and Torrontegui up to fourth and fifth, Ono sixth, Grassini seventh, and this is still Ralph Waldman battling as hard as he dares in third place. This is the battle for fourth, and it is a good battle now between... three riders, one would imagine we're going to hear a lot more of in the 125cc class.
Yeah, the little Giro guy, he's really a very bright little guy. He's back past Torrontegui again. I'm going to call him T-Man because it's too much of a mouthful. He's really, really a hard rider, Torrontegui.
So, great battle for fourth place. We'll be back with the 125cc Grand Prix in just a moment. But this is a great race for fourth place. Carlos Giro, well, Barry, he's made up for a dreadful start, hasn't he?
Yeah, incredible. You know, he's done a lot of hard work. Seeing how well he's going now, you could imagine what he'd have done at the front, can't you?
So here we go. Giro, and in fact, Torrontegui has gone up the inside of him. So Torrontegui now up to fourth place. Torrontegui up to fourth. This is Waldman. Is he having problems?
Yeah, that's so sad. I heard the bike as it came into the corner, heard it seize, so there's no doubt about that. You see he's got the clutch in there. Wow, all that is just pushing the bike as hard as he can. It just didn't have the horsepower, and he'd be devastated.
So Ralph Waldman is out of the race, so this now is the battle for third place, not the battle for fourth place. The German who had ridden so hard in the battle with Sakata out. And it's Herri Torrontegui now up into third place. Carlos Giro fourth. Ono in fifth place. Well, this is for very, very important World Championship points. And also, no, Barry, for a podium position.
Yeah, it's just going to be interesting to see coming down the straight here who's the quickest one out of this lot. If we get, when we get get to see him on the straight. Right now, have a look and see whose bike's the quickest. See the distance between 12 and 9 is not doing too much. If anything, you could say that Ono's bike is a little bit quicker.
The man with all the experience is the man at the back of that pack, isn't he? Fausto yep. Grassini, number two. So yep. you can't discount him in this type of battle, can you? But, oh, three into the hairpin.
You see Grassini there, just keeping a bit of a watching brief. He knows he's getting his pit signals. He knows he's got two or three laps to run. And he'll be letting them all fight out. But what he's most interested in is the leading guy in this bunch to make sure the leading guy doesn't get too much of a gap on the second place guy there. When I say second place, I mean second place in our picture here. Because what you do, you just sit back there and let them all fight against one another, and they're only thinking about the two or three around them, and then you just come up and nail them.
So 3.5 laps remaining. Dirk Raudies still leads the way by over 11 seconds. Sakata in second place. We're watching a tremendous battle for third place. They're side by side as they come round, and Carlos Girono back up into third place. Torrontegui is relegated to fourth, Ono in fifth place, and you're so, so right, Barry. Fausto Grassini in sixth place, and just letting the youngsters have a bit of a game in front of him before surely he's going to make a move, isn't he?
You see there, Fausto just looked over his shoulder just to make sure that he wasn't going to get nailed the same way as he wants to nail these guys, and he's doing exactly the right thing. But as I say, he's got to be very careful not to let the leading one of this bunch get too far away. Otherwise, you can be too clever for your own good, completely go and wreck it for yourself.
So, over the line they come. Three laps to go. This is the battle for third place at the opening round of the World Championship. Raudies has gone through. Sakata's gone through. They race now into the left-hander right across the track. Giro still holds on Ono. So the Japanese rider now making his presence felt. Torrontegui just behind him, then Grassini, then Oliver Koch. Up to the hairpin they come.
Yeah, you see now Grassini's just... Getting a bit of space between him and Oliver Koch. You'd have to say that Grassini would be the man that should do it out of this lot. I know it sounds a bit dark when you see him back there in the fourth position of this group, but the way he's riding, I just got a feeling.
Well, Carlos Giro qualified in pole position with a stunning lap towards the finish of the session yesterday, riding the Aprilia, but he got caught cold at the start, as did many of the riders, and he was way, way down off the pace in the early stages of the race. And he's just holding Torrontegui up, and Torrontegui now has got in front of Ono. And really, they're probably slowing themselves up with these sort of manoeuvres rather than pulling away, aren't they?
Well, they are, you know, and that's why Grassini's in the right position at the moment. But what he needs to do at the end of this lap, or sort of the beginning of the next lap, is... Whoa, nice move by Torrontegui there. Now, this is where Grassini's got to make his move now and at least sort of get really, really close to the bunch, to the leader of this bunch. Otherwise, he's going to leave it too late, because you only need a little mistake by someone that slows you up a bit and then you've blown your plane.
Around they come. Torrontegui in third place. Ono fourth. Giro fourth. In sixth place, Grassini. And in seventh place, Oliver Koch down over the start and finish line. Two
at
laps
Grassini,
to go.
Look at Grassini.
This man Ono, we don't know too much about him, but he looks brave to me.
Look at Grassini. Grassini's just got past Giro. So Grassini's the third one of that bunch now.
Torrentega up to third place. Ono trying to go around the outside of him. Sure, Torrentega on the brakes is going to take him. Which, yes, he is.
Oh, yeah, and Oliver Koch.
But Oliver Koch suddenly coming to the picture there.
Yeah, oh, dear.
And he's pushed to Giro. Grassini, the man we've been tipping well. He's at the back of that.
He's the back of that lot now.
Dear, oh dear. This is what 125cc racing is all about. This is a great race for third place. Torrontegui up into third place. Ono pushing him very hard, climbing all over him. Oliver Koch, who, to be perfectly honest, I think Barry and I have discounted a little bit, but he's looking very, very threatening now.
He is.
In sixth place. Good luck to him.
He's really in the right position at the moment.
So a lap and a half to go. Raudies way out in front. Sakata in second place. This is the battle for third. Herri Torrontegui back in the 125cc class after riding a 250 last season. He's in third place. 32 is the Japanese rider, Ono. In fourth place, we have Oliver Koch. In fifth place, Carlos Giro. And in sixth place, Fausto Grassini. This is the battle for the final position on the victory podium.
Right, well, Grassini can kiss it goodbye, because Torrontegui is too far in front now.
Heard that your old favourite Ezio Ginola out of the race, Barry.
Oh, dear me.
So it hasn't been a good day for some of the favourites, has it?
No, it hasn't. You know, it's the first race of the year and everybody's trying new things on their bikes. Their engineers have found that's going to make them go a million miles an hour faster, but they have to finish the race, don't they?
So, one lap to go. If they're going to do anything, they've got to do it now.
Well, you can rely on Ono to make an Ono at the hairpin. He's just got him.
Yes.
Right now, Torrontegui is good into this left-hander at the end of the straight here, into this little
Well, that's Oliver Cock, isn't it, who's really? Oliver Cock's on the inside.
Hey, got him. Oh, dear.
Oh, they've got down. Oh. Oliver Cock's got, I think he's taking Giro with him.
Giro.
He has, Oliver Cock, really. He was never, never going to get through that gap, was he?
Well, not only that, you see, Giro also was right up in there banging, you know, pushing, and... Watch this lot. Now watch Giro coming from the back here into your right, your screen. It was Giro's fault.
Yes, he went into the back of Cock and pushed him from back, didn't he?
Yeah, that's, it's nothing to do with Oliver Cock. That was totally Carlos Giro's fault.
Yeah, 21 years old, just a little bit inexperienced, but there we are. We mustn't take anything away from this gentleman, must we? Dirk Raudies, well, to say he led from the start, I think he led by a mile from the start, didn't he?
Yeah, a good explanation. Yeah, led by an arm and a leg.
Yeah, but Dirk Raudies on his way to his second ever Grand Prix victory. He now comes into the start and finish straight for the last time. The first man to win a 1993 World Championship race is the German 28-year-old Dirk Raudies, wins the 125cc race. In second place, we're expecting Japanese rider Kazuto Sakata. Here he comes. He's had a good battle, though, with Ralph Wardman before Ralph Wardman's Aprilia expired. But who's going to be in third place? Well, we've lost Oliver Cock. We've lost Carlos Giro, so let's have a look. Perhaps it's going to be the Japanese rider.
And Torrontegui.
Masafui Ono. Is he going to do it? Torrontegui trying to get past him.
I think...
Yes, well, he's... I don't know.
Oh,
I think
yes, Torrontegui. He got it.
The Spanish rider pinches the final position on the podium. And, well, let's be honest, Barry. The race, I think we felt at the start, has gone a bit flat because Raudies got away so much. That's nice. Shaking of hands there between Omo and Torrontegui. And, of course, number two, Fausto Grassini. And there, the difference.
That was close.
0.01 of a second, that battle for third place. We thought the race was going a bit flat, didn't we, when Raudies got away so much. But in fact, it turned into a tremendous scrap behind him.
Yeah, it was great. It's just sad that Giro, you know, made a big banzai job and it didn't work out. You know, I feel sorry for Oliver Cock because he really... Garry McCoy, 10th place. How about
that? There's some very welcome points indeed for Garry McCoy. We were talking about how well he rides in the wet, but he rode very well indeed in the dry conditions. So we're looking at the winner, say, 28-year-old German. And the second place man just behind him looks Sakata. He had a good ride, Sakata, didn't he?
He did.
Let's just run through those results. Dirk Raudies the winner. Sakata in second place. Torrontegui third. Ono in fourth place. Grassini fifth. Wada in fifth place. So let's... great victory to Dirk Raudies. We'll be back to Eastern Creek very shortly. Well, celebration time down in the pits. That's Dirk Raudies, a winner. Well, a very comfortable winner indeed of the 125cc race. Really, all the excitement going on behind him. That's Sakata who finished in second place. Good ride by him. He was pressured by Ralph Wardman, of course, till Ralph Wardman's Aprilia expired. And in third place, well, Torrontegui riding the Aprilia. Barry, a good race after a bit of a dull start.
Yeah, it was a great race. But, you know, the start, I just cannot believe that that wasn't red flagged. You know, if we can get it. Yeah, look, right, now watch the white lines and where the wheels are. See the guy going. Now watch the whip. Look.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, that was diabolical. Look at the guy on the third row of the grid. He's up to the second row of the grid again.
Raudies got a great start at Giro. Well, where is he, number nine? He's nowhere in the picture from pole position.
Well, he's there on the left-hand side, but he's just got really caught with his trousers down, if you like, because it was just such a fragmented start. You know, it's a shame, but
I've got to say, listening to what Wayne Rainey, champion, said, he said the riders have been told when the lights go from red to green, there would just be a two-second gap. It seems to me, perhaps, that the 125cc riders, being the first guys out on the grid, the first race of the season, probably in all the excitement, they probably completely forgot about it.
It could have been the 500s that were first. Okay, we'll go down to Charlie Stewart in the pits.
Thanks, Barry. Garry McCoy, it didn't rain, but 10th place, a great result.
Yeah, well, it's great. I wanted to finish in the top 10, or 10th was just fine, you know. I would have liked it to rain, you know, I would have had a better chance, but anyway, I went out there and done what I could, and the tyres were going off. Yeah, really slippery out there, but I done what I could and finished 10th, and it's great.
It augurs well for the rest of the season for you?
Sorry?
It augurs well for the rest of the season?
For sure. Yeah, the main thing for me was just to stay on the bike and go as hard as I could and finish a race, and that's what I'll be doing all year, so, yeah.
All right, congratulations. We'll be back with more from Eastern Creek right after this break.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Garry.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen.
Celebration time, the podium ceremony for the first time this season. In the middle, Dirk Raudies celebrates. On his left, Torrontegui, who finished in third place. On his right, Sakata, who finished in second place. Sunshine here at Eastern Creek, and the champagne about to flow about Dirk Raudies. Who can blame him? Only his second ever Grand Prix victory, and he's going to celebrate in great style. He got such a start. What, over 11 seconds he won the race by. But a Sakata, very, very impressive and enjoying the celebrations. Just gone out of the picture right side. And there's Herri Torrontegui. Well, 250cc runner last year, Barry, but looked very impressive on the 125.
Yeah, he definitely had a good ride. He hasn't had an awful lot of testing on it, you've got to say. But it shows what's going to come, because the more he gets used to that bike and the more he gets chance to, get some good bits for it. You've got to hand it to Raudies, though.
Yeah, Raudies. Congratulations, Dirk Raudies. The first win of the 1993 season. Well, Daryl Eastlake's in the pit talking to Daryl Beattie.
Daryl, we've been trying to work out what pace we reckon this race is going to be run at. We seem to have come around the 32-33 mark. How do you feel about that?
Last year, I consistently ran low 32s in the race and finished third. The other guys are around that mark, towards the end of the race, just a little bit quicker. For some reason, this year it doesn't seem to be much faster, so I think it's going to be, you'll find in the first five or six laps of the race, it'll be high 31s and then they'll slip into the 32s.
At the start of the 125 event, they seem to hold them back, and when the lights change, and some riders obviously got Raudies, he's got a really good advantage. I mean, is that a worry to you, seeing that already?
It's definitely not good if they hold us there for too long, the bikes don't like to be sitting still, especially at the moment it's so humid, and if we get held there too long, the clutches get hot, heats up, and a few guys can get quite angry.
Well, we've been keeping an eye on the weather. It did look like closing in, but now it seems to have moved away again, so we might get away with it.
Hopefully, yeah. It's been really funny. This morning was cool, and now it's gone humid, and they say thunderstorms, so it feels like it's going to be like that, thunderstorms, but, hopefully it'll hold out for us.
All right, and you're happy with the bike this morning? You can't do any more to it now?
No, we're stuck with what we got, so we've got to make the most of it.
All right, you've handled the whole week terrific, and I just hope you have a really good afternoon.
All right, thanks.
Thanks, Mike. Well, Daryl Eastlake talking to Daryl Beattie. Barry, well, it was an interesting start, wasn't it? I mean, we're still talking about the start. In fact, we've just watched another replay of it, but I'm sure the 500cc riders and the 250 riders, they're not going to be caught in the same way in any way at all, are they?
Well, no, they're not. I suppose the light side of it for them is the fact that theirs wasn't the first race, because, first race of the season, different regulations, etc., etc., and it's so hard to pick what the right thing to do is. But for sure, as you say, they're not going to get caught out.
An absolute dead cert. The 125cc riders win in Malaysia next Sunday. They're not going to be caught out either, are they?
No, it's just sad, because it would have been a real absolute monster of a race.
So the 250cc race to come, back to Eastern Creek in a moment.
Touch this. Yo, let me bust the funky lyrics.
Touch this.
Fresh new kicks and bands. You got it like that, now you know you want to dance. So move out of your seat and get a fight going and catch this beat while it's rolling. Hold on, pump a little bit and let the noise go on like that. Like that. Pull a little bit, just don't fall on back. Let them know that you're too much. And this is a beat. Can't touch.
To battle for the Aussie Grand Prix.
And from Woodcote, and look at Barry Sheene doing an absolutely monumental wheelie as the front wheel rears right up as they go down the top. That one. Not only looks over his shoulder, but takes his left clutch hand off the handlebar and waves to Kenny Roberts. And here's Kenny Roberts' answer. Don't you wave at me, young man. This is it. At 130 miles an hour, the checkered flag is out. Kenny Roberts and Barry Sheene is gaining. And there is less than a machine's length in it with a fantastic race.
Crying out bloody loud. You know, don't you people have enough to do? You know, we have enough to do on a race day without stupid things. Well, why the bloody hell didn't they sort it out when they first came through? They never said a word. They stamped it yesterday and the day before. Now on race day, you want to start causing trouble.
I don't know.
Well, no, you shouldn't have bloody passed it in the first place.
What John McEnroe was to tennis, Barry Sheene was to 500cc's. Colourful, controversial, and the best in the world. He dominated racing in the late 70s, winning back-to-back world titles in 1976 and 77. His success, though, did come at an enormous physical cost. Over his 16-year career, his body was to suffer the agony of broken bones more than 60 times and remains a graphic reminder of the dangers when riding on the edge.
I melted west to fix my wings. I've done all the